everyone. I want to welcome you back. I want to welcome you to another episode of our program today. You know, I know that it's been up to 3 weeks now that we've not really released a video. You know, it's just because we've been going through a lot. The Lord has been working so mightily with us, you see. The Lord, there is a book the Lord wants me to put together, and I've been working on the book. And by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, you know, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, I know that that book will be ready very soon. It will be going to print it very soon. And when it is out, I would love all of us to get it, because it's got a lot of revelations that the Lord wants to communicate to you through that medium, you see. So a lot has been happening. Although it's been, it looks like we have been quiet. We've been quiet. No, we've been doing a lot. We've been preparing for a higher level of our work, in our work with the Lord. You see, we are preparing to launch out, to launch into another level, you see, from in doing what the Lord has asked us to do. Because the Lord told me, he said, a lot depends on what you're doing. He said, keep at what you're doing, because a lot is at stake. A lot depends on what you're doing, you see. And today, so I welcome you to this wonderful episode. You know, today we're talking about something so insightful. What we'll be sharing today is something so insightful and so mind-blowing, you see. Something so mind-blowing. The Lord has always longed to communicate these things to the body of Christ. You see, when the Lord was speaking some of these things to me, when I was getting this revelation, I was wow. You know, it changed me. And I also believe God, and I know that it will also change you. So sit back and relax. You see, sit back and relax as we explore the words today. As we explore the words today. You know, a lot of people have also always asked me, you see, they keep on hearing when I say the Lord asked me, the Lord told me, the Lord asked me, the Lord has commanded me, the Lord has done, you know, they'll say, did Jesus appear to you? Who, you see? And I'll be looking at them. I'll be looking at them. And I'll try to explain to them. But I want to ask a question. Who is the Lord to you? Who do you think is the Lord? Do you know the Lord? Who is the Lord to you? You see? The answer is in the scriptures. The scriptures have given us the answer. You see, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. And I want us to look into that scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Praise the Lord. He said, now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. He said, now the Lord is that Spirit. So he's telling us that the Lord is the Spirit. The Lord is the Spirit. The Lord, when you hear me talking, I said, the Lord has told me, the Lord has commanded me, the Lord has, is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Lord. You see? And Jesus is the Holy Spirit. And God is, you know, Bible said that God is a spirit. What kind of spirit is it? It's the Holy Spirit. You see? It said, and the Spirit is that Lord. So when you hear me speaking of the Lord, that the Lord has commanded, the Lord has told me, the Lord has revealed these things to me, I'm not talking of Jesus coming to me in person. If Jesus has ever come to me in person, I will tell you. But whatever revelations we've got, is of the Lord. The Lord is the Spirit. Is that Spirit? You see? Is that Spirit? The Lord is that Spirit. So I want you to understand, so that you not get this confused, so that you follow the teachings, you follow our communication, our conversations, you see? So that it will be clear to you. Praise the Lord. So today, hallelujah. So today, the Lord Spirit, the Holy Spirit has commanded me, you see. He wants me to talk about something so dear to him. This is something so dear to the Holy Spirit. He has been longing to communicate it since. And the Holy Spirit today has commanded me. It has been a long time he gave this thing to me. But he held me back, said, the time is not yet right. Now is the right time. He says, speak, speak, speak. You see, today we'll be looking at the foundation and the righteous. You see, the foundation and the righteous. What are the foundations and the righteous? You see, why has the Holy Spirit tried to communicate this thing? Why does the Holy Spirit want me to communicate this thing? You see, to share this thing, to bring this revelation to the body of Christ. It's for a reason. And that reason is found in the book of Psalms. Chapter 11, verse 3. Let us go there. Psalm chapter 11, verse 3. Let us see why the Holy Spirit wants to communicate these things. Now, Psalm chapter 11, verse 3. I'm reading. He said, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? This is King James. He said, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Meaning that the foundations are so important to the righteous. What are the foundations? So a person can have his foundation destroyed. You see, this song. You see, this song captures everything. You know, he said, home cries the soul righteous. Because a foundation, he said, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The foundation can be destroyed. Something can go wrong with the foundations. You see, it's like a building. A building that has a wrong foundation. The foundation was not laid properly. What will happen? What do you think will happen to that? A minute ago, what he said? He said, every other stone is a sinking sand. It's a disaster. You see, but Bible is telling us that if the foundation be destroyed, there is a disaster that is waiting to happen. What can the righteous do? The righteous will collapse. He said, oh, I want us to look at something Jesus said about foundations. Let us go to Book of Matthew, chapter 7. Go with me.
Home, cries the solid rock I stand.
So I've got to Matthew chapter 7, and we'll be reading from verse 24. He said, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, he said, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. This is saying that it's on a sure foundation, on a solid foundation. You know, that is what Jesus meant by a rock. You see, he said, verse 25, he said, and the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. It's telling you, the one that cannot be destroyed, the foundation that cannot be destroyed, is the foundation that is founded on the word. Building. So that house is anyone who hears the sayings of mine and does them. He said, I liken him unto a wise man that builds on a solid foundation, on a solid rock. A foundation that is not shaken, that cannot be destroyed. He said, these words of mine, the words that he spoke. That is why the foundations are so important to the righteous. The Bible, to the extent the Bible wrote, it said, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The righteous will collapse. That is why that song said, every other ground is a sinking sand. It's a disaster waiting to happen. And it will happen. If it goes unchecked, it will happen. It will collapse. You see, we know after a time, they fortify the bridges, the flyovers. They tell you because a collapse is imminent. They fortify it. Fortify your life. As a righteous, fortify your life. You see, he told us. He said, I want us to see. He said, and verse 26 said, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, he said, shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. You see, every other ground is a sinking sand. Look at it. He said, upon the sand. He said, 27 said, and the rains descended, and the floods came, and the wind blew, and beat upon the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Oh, such a terrible end. And the same Bible is saying, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The righteous will collapse. Who is a righteous man, first of all? We have, in our previous messages, in our previous videos and everything, you know, we've established it. The righteous is a man in Christ. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, he said, he hath made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that in him we might be made the righteousness of God. It's only in him that you are made. You see, so it's talking about a man in Christ. He's the righteous. Praise the Lord. The man in Christ is the righteous. So, but he's telling you that man in Christ can have his foundation destroyed. He can destroy his foundations. And we have seen what are the foundations. Jesus said, the foundation, the sayings of mine. The sayings of mine, you see, they built on that foundation. The apostles took it. Apostle Paul, we want to look at what Apostle Paul said, because that is the key, it's central to everything we want to talk about today. So join me as we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Praise the Lord. And we'll be reading from verse 9. It's a lengthy one, but we'll go so that we'll get a lot of insights here. You see, he said, For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. He's saying, we are working together with God. You see, Jesus said, these were sayings of mine. So apostles still continued with those words because they said they are working with God. The same Jesus, they're working with Jesus. You see. And now we are the buildings. The building. You see, they are working. They are building. He said, we are God's building. So the building said, if the foundations be wrong, what shall the righteous do? So the righteous is the building, is the foundation, which is the teaching. The teaching, he said, these sayings of mine, they are the foundation. So who's the righteous? The one in Christ. So he's saying all that. These words, you know, that he believes, that he does, that he practices, that if they are faulty, if they are destroyed, you see, what can he do? Praise the Lord. So we'll go ahead. He said, in verse 10, he said, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation. Oh, Sandara Mandishide. Paul said something. He said, I have laid. He's not saying, I will lay the foundations. He has laid the foundations. He laid foundation. He's not telling you another person will lay. He said, I have laid the foundation. Everything he has done is foundational. Build upon them. You see, we are meant to. He said, everything that he has done is laying the foundation. You see, and he said something. He said, and another buildeth up thereupon. Sorry, thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. You see. He said, I have laid the foundation. Apostle Paul is not saying any other person laid the foundation. He said, I have laid the foundation. He didn't even say other apostles have laid the foundation. He said, I laid the foundation. He's peculiar to himself. He's talking about him because Apostle Paul knew more than every other person. All of his contemporaries, he knew more than them. The revelation of God was more, God gave him more than he gave other people. He knew more. And he was saying, he said, I have laid the foundation. He didn't even consider others, the other apostles. Because why did he say that? Because he knew. Because if they must lay a foundation, they must lay the same foundation that he's laying. He knew that. That was why he said, ye are God's, we are laborers with God. He said, and ye are God's building. So you are the building. The building is talking about there. He said, if the foundation be faulty, what shall the righteous? Because the righteous is a building to God. He said, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We are a building for the Holy Spirit, for the habitation of the Holy Spirit. See. So he's talking about our foundation. And Jesus, like he said, the words. He said, anyone who hears this word, you know, I liken to a man who built on a foundation. Meaning that the teachings and the foundation. So Paul saying, I've laid the foundation. What that foundation is? His teachings. We are foundational. You cannot, you shouldn't lay another foundation. He said, which we will see. He said, his teachings, we are foundational. Verse 11, he said, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Which is Jesus Christ. He said, he has laid the foundation. He said, no man can lay another foundation. No other person, you see, no other person can lay any other foundation apart from the one that he has laid. He said, and that foundation that he has laid, he said, everything that he has taught them is built on the foundation that is Jesus Christ. Everything that he has taught was built on that foundation, which was Jesus Christ. So if any other thing that is not in consonance with what Paul says is not built on Jesus Christ, that is what he's saying to us. He said, no other foundation can any man lay except that which has already been laid. A foundation has been laid. It's just for you to start building on what has been laid. Don't build another one. You see. Don't build on another one. In verse 12, he said, now if a man build upon this foundation, he said, now if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble. You see, he's stubble. He's talking about materials for building. He said, some materials are of gold, quality of gold. Some materials are of the quality of silver. Some materials are precious stone. Some materials are wood, hay, and stubble. You see, how you do the teachings. He's telling us the teachings, what you teach them in church. In churches, this is it. He said, some of them are of the quality, the grade. You know, when you are grading them, he said you can grade them as gold, as pure gold. You see. Some are silver, some are precious stone, some are, he said, wood, some are even wood, tars, grass. You see. He said, for every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. So he said, every man's work will pass through the fire. Imagine, he's talking about some people building with gold, silver, precious stone, wood. How can you imagine when the wood passes through fire? when grass, when hay, grass that passes through fire, what do you think will happen? It will be destroyed, it will be burnt off. He said, okay, verse 14 said, if a man's work, sorry, he said, shall be revealed by fire. 13 said, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. You see, imagine if I've been building with grass, with wood, and you are passing wood through fire. What do you think will happen? He said, the fire is, it will be destroyed, consumed. This is why the Bible has told you. He said, if the foundations be faulty, what shall the righteous do? What can the righteous do? Because it shall be passed, you will pass through fire. You will be revealed. He said, that day, it's not now. He said, that day, a day is coming, the judgment day of Christ. The second coming will reveal. He said, it shall pass through fire. Praise the Lord. Let us go. He said, 14. He said, if any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. So reward is given only after your work has passed through fire. Can it stand? He said, but if a man's work shall be burnt, Basita Brady, he shall suffer loss. If a man's work shall be burnt, don't give your life to a man that will build you up so that you'll be burnt up on the last day. He's talking about burning the fire, trying. He's talking about the lives of men, of people. He said, if this thing is burnt up, if a man's work is burnt up, how would you go and commit your life into a man that will build you up to the extent that you would be burnt at the last day, you still be rejected? So what is it for you to have even built upon? Praise the Lord. He said, if a man's work, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. He said, even the man himself who has built this thing would be saved, but he will have to pass through fire to see if he can survive it. If he's not so, if he cannot survive, he will also be lost. He will also be burnt up. That is what the Bible is saying. You see, he's telling us. But one thing, you know, is verse 11. He said, verse 10 and 11, he said, I have laid the foundation and another built. He said, I have laid the foundation. Paul did not say another person has laid. He said, I have laid the foundation. His teachings, we are foundational. Anything that is not his teaching is not foundation. Hasn't been laid by him. He said, and that, verse 11, he said, and that no other foundation can no man lay than that is which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. So everything he has done, which is the foundation he has laid, is on Christ Jesus. Every other person, any other person who's laying a different foundation is not on Christ. That is what he's trying to tell us. And what foundation did he root? You see, among the things, the foundations given to us by Paul. Paul called us the saints of God. He said, to the saints in Corinth, to the saints in Ephesus, to the saints in Colossae. He never called us, you see, he never called us Christians. Where did that name Christian come from? It's not on the building. Paul is telling you, it's not foundational. You are building. Building on Christianity is building on a foundation that is not Christ. That is out of Christ, outside Christ. You see, don't build on a foundation that is not Christ. He said, I have laid the foundation. Paul has laid. He said, no other person can lay. He didn't say, you see, you know, like people have asked them. They said in Acts chapter 11 that the people called them Christ. Paul did not say the people are laying the foundation. He said, I am laying the foundation. As a master builder, I am laying the foundation. He did not say people are laying the foundation. The other people are laying the foundation. No other person should give you a foundation which we are building. Build on that foundation which has already been laid. That foundation which has already been laid. Paul laid the foundation of saints. He said, saints in everywhere. Saints in Colossae. Saints in this. Saints in that. It's a foundation. You see, building on Christianity is building on a shaky foundation. On a shaky foundation. On a shaky foundation. Foundation that is not Christ. That foundation is not Christ. You see, I used to say it before. I said, I'm a Christian. I'm this, I'm that, I'm that, I'm that. Until the Lord told me these things. And ever since that day, I stopped saying it. If you've been following our video, you've never heard me talk about Christian, talk about it. I'm talking about the saints. I'm a saint of God. Don't call me Christian. I'm not. I'm not Christian. No, I'm more than Christian. I am a saint of God. I am a saint, a man in Christ, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That is who I am. A saint of God. You see, the Bible, even in Revelation chapter 15, verse 3, the Bible said that Jesus is the king of the saints. He never called, he never said he's the king of Christians. No. Revelation everywhere. Everywhere. When the Lord spoke these words to me, when he was telling me about this Christian and this saint and everything, he said, you're not a Christian. You are a saint of God. You see, after the Lord spoke to me, I went to carry my concordance. I went to study that word. I found something so amazing and so mind-blowing. So telling. The word Christian only appeared in the Bible 3 times. Only appeared in the Bible 3 times. And 2 times was used by stark unbelievers. First of all, the people that called them Christians in Acts. You see. The disciples we are called. The people that called them, we are not disciples. So they could not even, they were not disciples. You see. In Acts chapter 11, verse 26. Acts 11, 26. He called, he said, and the disciples, let us look at it. Acts 11:26. He said, and when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they were assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. You see. Who called them? The people called them. Said the disciples. So the people that called them, that called the disciples Christians. We are not disciples. Because he would have said other disciples called their fellow disciples. But he said the disciples were called by people. You see, this was the first time it was used. You see. And the second usage of that word was by King Agrippa. When Paul defended himself before him, was telling him of the revelation of God, how God instructed him, and you know his ministry, how God gave him a ministry. He received a ministry of the Lord after his encounter with the Lord, his conversion. He was telling him, you know, the devil worked so much in Agrippa. Agrippa shouted, God went into a rage. He shouted and said, Paul, stop. Said he would have even made me a Christian. He said, too much learning has made you mad. That is a rage by the devil. The devil got infuriated because he was laying out the mystery of Christ before him. What did Jesus say? He said, they will bring you before kings for an opportunity for you to tell them the gospel. So when he was telling him the gospel, the devil walked in him. He began rage. He went into a rage and tried to shout Paul down. He said, too much learning has made you. He said, you would have converted me to be a Christian. That was the second time. A stark unbeliever using the word. And what did the Bible say? What did the Bible say? Okay, let us look at 1 Corinthians. Chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. You know, he said something. He said, now we have received not the spirit of the world. So the world has a spirit. You see, the world has a spirit. And every man, there's something you have to know. Every man speaks by the spirit. A spirit gives every man utterance. No, every man represents a spirit. Jesus said, anyone who is not for me is against me. You must be for someone. If you are not for the Lord, you are against him. You are for someone. That means you are for someone. The fact that you are not for him, you are for another person. Look at what Jesus is saying. He said, for now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things which are freely given to us. God. You see, not of the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God. So he mentioned there are two spirits here. But where I'm going is verse 14. He said, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. You see, he said he cannot receive revelations from God. You see, there is something I will say about this thing. He said, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. He said, the natural man. So, first of all, I showed us that there are two spirits, either the spirit of this world or the spirit of God. And who is the God of this world? Satan is the God of this world. So the spirit which is of the world is the spirit of Satan. So he's now saying that any man, who the natural man, cannot receive the things of the Spirit of God. He cannot receive revelations from the Spirit of God. But the Spirit of God can speak through him. He can put words in his mouth, but he cannot give him, because he said why he cannot receive revelation. Speaking is just to speak. He doesn't need to interpret it, to check it. But he said he cannot discern it. He cannot check it properly. Is it of the Lord, or is it, what is it? He cannot discern it. It's foolishness unto him. So he cannot utter a revelation. So they cannot tell us who we are. That is what I'm trying to say. The natural man, he cannot receive it. It's not of God. That thing that he called us Christian was not, that revelation was, he didn't receive it of God. He received it of the spirit of this world. It wasn't from the Lord. No. Don't build on that. You see, don't build on that. A lot of preachers, a lot of even men of God, you know, try to justify and redefine what the world has set as religion. You see, the spirit that gave them is the spirit of religion. The spirit that called them Christians was the spirit of religion. They have changed, yeah, Christianity is not religion. But the people that brought it for it to be a religion. You see, and when I was meditating on it, there was something the Lord told me. He said, no amount of redefinition will make it not to be what it was intended to be. No redefinition, saying Christianity is divinity in humanity. We are not even humans. The Bible said we are sharers of divine nature. We have been taken away from humanity, from human race. We are not in the human. No, we are not. When you are talking of human race, you don't count me in. I'm of heavenly race. I'm of divine race. I'm of divinity. A divine being. That is who I am. There is nothing human about me. There is nothing human about me. The same with Jesus. There was nothing human while he was walking this earth. The only thing that even made it was just because he had a body. He said, a body you have prepared for me. Jesus knew he was not body. A body you have prepared for me. Me separate, a body separate. So he was just walking in a container. You see. And the Lord, you see, the most ignorant man in this earth is not a man who did not go to university. No, or who did not go to school, who does not have formal education. No. He's a man who still believes that he's dust. He said, dust we are, dust we shall return to. A man who believes, that is the most ignorant man in the whole universe. Ignorant of all men is the man who still believes that. For a man is a spirit. Jesus said, a body you have prepared for me. Preparing a body. So it's the same saying, oh, let me not deviate. I don't want to deviate. You see. He said, for they cannot receive the things of God. They cannot receive the thing. Revelations, they cannot receive revelations from the Holy Spirit because they have to check a revelation out before you speak it. You see, when the Lord spoke all these things, I had to study. I found out Christians only appeared 3 times in the Bible. But saints appeared 150 times. Saints appeared 150 times. It was used how many times in the Revelation? He said, Christ and his saints, everything and his saints. He never said Jesus and his Christians. No. He said Jesus is coming for the saints. He's not coming for the Christians. He never said, I'm coming for the Christians, or they shall be called Christians. No. You know? And he never said that. You see, when the Lord spoke all these things to me, so first of all, I want you to understand that the people who called them Christians, we are not even disciples. So they we are not born again. So they could not receive revelation from God. God can speak through them, but God cannot give them revelation. And that word, Christianity, was meant to be a revelation if it was going to be from our Lord. Because that is novel. That was a foundation. It was novel. So it was meant to be a revelation. And now the same Bible is telling you that any man who is not in Christ cannot receive revelation. So those men cannot receive that thing of the Lord. They could not have received that thing of the Lord. They could not. You see. And when the Lord told all these things, I began meditating and speaking to the Lord, you know, and we're talking and everything. The Lord told me something. He said, the spirit that called them Christians was targeting one thing, was targeting that choice words. Sense used by the apostles. You see, he wanted to destroy, to bastardize it. You see, that which is precious to the Lord, Satan has been seeking to bastardize it and gave them Christians and called them Christians. You see, he told me, that was what he told me. He said, it's to bastardize our word, to make it. That is why today now they are telling you, in our world, that a saint is a dead man, a man who died, and some other person declares him a saint after he has died. This is a man who prayed, who can say, I'm a sinner, have mercy on me, pray for me, a sinner, now to the hour of my death. Say, after he died, said he'll become a saint. How can you become a saint in death when you were a sinner in your existence? It is trying to bring, to bastardize and to bastardize the teaching of the word of God, to bring confusion, you see, and with it today. Where did it come from? If that thing was a revelation, the proper revelation, why didn't the disciples use it? The disciples, they were the ones called the Christians. Why didn't they use it? None, apart from Peter, used it in the Bible. And where Peter used it, in 2 Peter, let us, in 1 Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 4, let us look into that. I will say something about it. I'll read it from Amplified. 1 Peter chapter 4. Verse 16. He said, I want to read it from Amplified. He said, but if one is ill-treated and suffers as a Christian, which he is contemptuously called, let him not be ashamed, but give glory to God that he is deemed worthy to suffer in this name. Oh, Mandesh Dobrati. So he said that name is suffering. He said, contemptuously, to be mockingly, derogatorily, disdainfully called. So it is a mocking word. It's like calling someone, he said that this person is a nigger. A nigger is a negro. It's a derogatory word. To mock him. Although some black Americans later ran with it and started saying, this is my nigger, yo, nigger, you know, doing a lot of things. Nigger, nigger, nigger. But they didn't know. The word was meant, was derogatory in the origin and usage. You see. So why did the apostles, why did Paul, you know, Peter, all of them, you know, James and John, all of them, Matthew, why didn't they run with that? You see? Why didn't Paul run with it to start calling people Christian? Because they were the ones, the first called them that one. Why? So where did he even start from today? How did he come about? Who brought it? So don't build on it. You see? That is a foundation that is shaking. He said, if the foundations be destroyed, Satan should not give us a baptismal name. Apostle has called us sent. Let us go with that. Apostle Paul called us sent. He never called us Christians. Let us go with that. You see, after this revelation, after the Holy Spirit revealed all these things to me, spoke all these things to me, I was sharing it with one of my friends. You see, I was sharing it with one of my friends. He said a lot of things. He said, hey, I don't think people will believe this thing you're saying. I don't think people will start taking. I told him something. I said, no. If anyone truly loves the Lord, he said, the scriptures are given to us for what? For correction, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness. These things I'm taking them from the scriptures. I said, you should be, anyone who loves God after hearing me should be able to, should adjust himself, should be able to adjust. You see? Because the love of God will cause him to adjust himself. He's not doing, don't temptuously call. What does he mean to become? It's coming from, you know, this person is speaking, this person. No. The Lord is the one speaking to you. I'm not the one speaking to you. The Lord is the one speaking to you. Because I speak in his name. I'm not speaking in my name. He said, go ye therefore in my name. Go ye in my name. He didn't say, go in your name. Go ye in my name. So if you go in his name, we are doing it as if it was him. So I'm speaking in his name. He said, what foundation? He said, I've laid, as Paul said, as a master builder, I have laid the foundation. And he laid the foundation of sainthood. He never laid the foundation of Christianity. He never used that word for once. Why are we building on the foundation of Christianity? Christianity only appeared in the Bible 3 times. Why have we chosen to build on the one that appeared 3 times and discard saints that appeared in the Bible 150 times? Why? He said, once have I spoken and twice have I heard. How can you now discard what was once, what was twice, and take what was once? You see, the Lord spoke those words to me once, and I heard them twice. And I adjusted myself. When I was born, when I was growing up, even some years back, I used to say, God, I'm a Christian. Thank God I'm a Christian. Thank God I'm a Christian. But the Holy Spirit corrected me. Oh, so if I was able to adjust, you should be able to adjust to it. Because why is judgment going to come? Because he spoke to some other person and he adjusted. And he's now speaking to you, you can now adjust. So if another person could do it, you could as well do it. So you are he is righteous in condemning you for not doing it. You see, he said about Noah. He said Noah condemned his generation. How did he condemn his? Because he did the right thing and they did the wrong thing. So if he could do the right thing, they could also do the right thing, but they chose to do the wrong. That was why how he condemned them. So condemnation is also a work in him. Because anyone who cannot do what he's doing, he's passing judgment on that person. That is why the Lord said, that is why the Bible said. He said something in the Bible. He said, there are 3 things that the world know not about. They do not understand. He said, they are wrong about this thing. In John, he said, God's righteousness. He said, sin, righteousness, and God's judgment. You see? Because they think they will only be judged in heaven. The judgment is taking place here. If the Lord has spoken the words to you, and you fail to do it, you are already judged. He said, sorry. He said, for the Lord judgeth no man. He said, I have not come to judge the world. He said, but you have the one that will judge. He said, the words I've spoken unto you will be your judge in the last day. If you fail to do them, you see, like as you're hearing today now, if you fail to adjust, the Lord will hold you liable for it. Like he talked about idle words. He said, for anyone, he said, for men shall be held responsible, held accountable to judgment for every idle word that they speak. Now he's telling you, foundation, if you build on the foundation, it is done on the wrong foundation. It is a disaster waiting to happen. It will collapse. That building cannot stand. It will be pulled down. It will collapse. Imagine a man building a house, a 50-story building on a wrong foundation. Would you go and stay there? Would you go and live there? You see, it will collapse. It will definitely. It must collapse. The same thing the Lord is warning us today. Through me, he's warning you. He said, don't build on the wrong foundation. For a foundation that is not built on what Paul has said, what Paul has done, he didn't say the people are built. He said, he didn't say the people are laying the foundation. He said, I have laid the foundation, build on the foundation I have laid. So if you build on the foundation that people have laid, you have built on the wrong foundation. And that foundation, that is why it's faulty. The Lord has told, he said, if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Don't build on that foundation. Go, move away from that foundation. Build on Christ. He said, build on the foundation of sainthood. Paul called us, he said, the saints in Corinth, the saints in Colossae, the saints in Ephesus, in everywhere. He never called us Christians. So I know that these words, as you've heard today, they will bless you. These words will bless you. Because they blessed me. They enriched me. They moved me from one position to another position. I'm now where I am. Oh, every day I'm joyful. I spend my days in plenty. In joy. I'm so joyful. I'm in peace. I'm at peace with myself. I'm at peace with everything. You see, the revelations of the Lord. I am aware of how a lot of people have tried. A lot of men of God have tried to redefine Christianity. That Christianity is not a religion, but it was meant to be a religion from the beginning because it was of this world. It's never divinity. Anything that is born of this world was born, it was given to them by the spirit of this world, by the God of this world. The spirit of this world belongs to the God of this world. You see? It was meant to be a religion. So don't. That is what, that is, you see, that is agenda for one world religion, to say everybody is practicing the same religion, but we are not. Build on sainthood so that you take yourself away from religion. Christianity is religion. If you want, argue with it from now to tomorrow. The people that brought it to be religion, is not a revelation from God. The revelation from God is sainthood, and I'm a saint of God. In Christ Jesus, I am a saint, sealed for the day of redemption, the day of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. Now, I want to give anyone who's hearing the sound of my voice, but he's not born again. You see, he has not made Jesus his personal Lord and Savior. He's not in Christ. You see. I want to give him an opportunity because the Bible said the word is nigh thee in your mouth. It's the closest thing to you, the nearest thing to you. So you cannot give any excuse to our God. You see, I've spoken to a lot of people. They said, I'm Muslim. Nobody is Muslim. I'm Catholic. I can't do this. I'm this. I'm Jews. I can't do this. Nobody is anything. All these things are human classification. The classification of this world. You see, a man is a spirit. You are a spirit. Know it. You are not Catholic. You are not Muslim. No, you are a spirit. So he said, anyone who is there. So anyone can be, even a Muslim can be there. A Buddhist can be there. Anybody at all can be there. He said, anyone, not excluding anybody. He did not exclude some people. He didn't say this. He said anyone who is in Christ is a new creature. He didn't call them Christians. A new creature. That was Paul laying the foundation. Praise the Lord. So I want to give that person an opportunity that is hearing me to make Jesus his personal Lord and Savior, you see, and escape eternal death. So if you're hearing my voice, I want you to repeat this voice, to repeat these words after me. These words will catapult you into Christ and make you. That's what the Bible said in Colossians chapter 1 from 12, with 12 and 13. It said, made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. And had translated us. You see. And had translated us. He said, giving thanks unto the Father who hath made us meet, hath qualified us. He hath qualified you to be the partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. You see, and hath translated us from the dominion, from the domain of darkness to the kingdom of God, dear son, kingdom of heaven. You see, the next video we will release, we'll be releasing a video on understanding the kingdom, the difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. There is a difference. You know, a lot of preachers keep on saying that they use interchangeably, but there is a difference. The Spirit of the Lord has told me there is a difference. He gave me insight into that. So we'll be talking about it in the next video. And I want everybody to watch out for that because it will be so insightful. Praise the Lord. So if you're hearing the voice and you're not born again, so, you know, repeat these words after me. Believe them sincerely. Believe in them and repeat after me. Father God, I come to you today. I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart that Jesus came and died for me. And you raised him from the dead on the third day for my justification. I make Jesus my Lord and Savior. From today, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. You know, if you have made that confession, if you have repeated those words after me, I want to congratulate you and welcome you to the household of God. You see, you are now a child of God. You have been removed from a creature of God to the child of God, to the Son of God. You have received the power now. He has given you the power. Because you have received it, he has given you the power to become the sons of God. So now you are. Congratulations to you. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. You know, always, always check for updates so that you'll be notified, so that you will get words that will help you, to build your life, on the foundation which no man can lay, which is Christ. That foundation which has been laid. You see, may the Lord bless you and keep you, because he's able to keep you from falling. He's able to keep you. He's able to nourish you. Praise the Lord. He will send men to you that will help actualize the plan of God in your life. Until we see again, remain blessed. You are a carrier of God. God is in you and is with you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.